Now, OJ Simpson, the former American footballer who was controversially cleared of double murder, has died this morning. He rose to the highest of highs as a sporting icon and Hollywood star, then fell to the lowest of lows, finding himself at the centre of the trial of the century. More from US correspondent Alison Petrowski.
It was the car chase that changed everything.
I think I just saw OJ Simpson on the 5 freeway. He's heading north.
For 2 hours in June of 1994, America stopped and watched one of their most decorated athletes on the run.
This is AC. I have OJ in the car.
Okay.
Right now, we're okay, but you got to tell the police to just back off. He's still alive, but he got a gun to his head.
Orenthal James Simpson was wanted for the murder of his ex-wife, Nicole Brown Simpson, and her friend, Ron Goldman. This slow-speed chase, a stunning fall from grace, the Football Hall of Famer became the fugitive, and then a high-profile defendant in a case dubbed the Trial of the Century, with rolling TV coverage. A critical piece of evidence, a pair of bloodied gloves found at the crime scene.
If it doesn't fit, you must acquit.
The gloves were too small, and Simpson walked away a free man.
We, the jury, in the above entitled action, find the defendant, Orenthal James Simpson, not guilty of the crime of murder.
But his life slid from there. In 1997, he was found liable for their murders in a civil suit. In 2006, he sold a book manuscript titled If I Did It and posed a hypothetical account of the murders he denied. The next year, he was arrested after he and other men invaded a hotel room of sports memorabilia dealers and stole a trove of collectibles. He claimed he was taking back stolen possessions.
How do you plead, Mr. Simpson?
Not guilty.
But a jury convicted him on all counts of robbery and kidnapping. He served the minimum 9 years in a Nevada state prison before walking free in 2017.
I've done my time. I'd just like to get back to my family and friends.
For more, US correspondent Alison Petrowski joins us from Los Angeles. Ali, good morning. He was a divisive figure. How is America reacting to news of his death?
Well, Soph, I think you'd be hard-pressed to find someone in America that didn't have an opinion about O.J. Simpson. 93 million people tuned in to watch that car chase live as it happened through Greater Los Angeles. 150 million Americans tuned in as that verdict was handed down at the Los Angeles Superior Court. I think initially the reaction today, Sophie, was surprise, because while people knew about O.J. Simpson's diagnosis, he had been public about it for a couple of months. He'd been saying that he felt remarkably well, posting videos saying that he believed he was beating this thing. But it appears in the last week his health had taken a turn and his family and friends made the trek to Las Vegas to say their goodbyes. Reaction very mixed today, Sophie. We've had the NFL Hall of Fame pronouncing him as one of the greats of the game. But meanwhile, Gloria Allred, who was one of the representatives of Nicole Brown Simpson's family during that trial, she says his death is a reminder of a failed system.
Simpson's death reminds us that the legal system failed, battered women, and especially Nicole. And if there had been real consequences the first time, perhaps he wouldn't have been so emboldened as to go and kill the mother of his children.
Caitlyn Jenner, equally blunt but a little bit more succinct, Sophie, she simply said, good riddance. And as for the other victim's family members, Fred Goldman, the father of Ron Goldman, he released a statement saying, the only thing that I have to say today is that this is a further reminder of the loss of my son Ron. So if O.J. Simpson died still owing those victims' families more than $100 million.
Ali Petrowski with the latest. Thank you. Well, police have returned to bushland south of Ballarat in their latest search effort to find missing mother Samantha Murphy. Gillian Lantouris has the developments.
Although the search will be scaled back today, police will be out in numbers in search of the body of missing Ballarat mum Samantha Murphy. Cadaver dogs were brought in for the first time yesterday to assist with the search, but sadly no trace of Samantha was found. Today's search will focus on the Enfield State Park area, which is about 30 kilometres south of Samantha Murphy's Ballarat East home and about 25 kilometres south of Buninyong State Forest, which is where Samantha Murphy's phone was last detected. Now, police say that evidence from a number of sources is what has led them to this specific spot.
At this point of the investigation, it's about getting new intelligence and either
moving with it or eliminating it.
22-year-old Patrick Stevenson has been charged with murder over the suspicious disappearance of Samantha Murphy. It's understood he is not cooperating with the police investigation. Tonight there will be a rally held in Ballarat to honour Samantha Murphy, as well as two other women who were allegedly murdered at the hands of a man in Ballarat since February. The most recent being Hannah McGuire, who was found in a burnt-out car on Friday in nearby Scarsdale.
People are devastated. They're shaken to the core and grieving. People are hurting a lot here and really angry as well. And these are all really normal and understandable responses.
Samantha Murphy's husband, Mick, says he is holding on to hope that his wife will be found and brought back home.
The Albanese government's hand-picked boss of the Productivity Commission has raised concerns about their new manufacturing policy. Live to Federal Politics reporter Eliza Edwards at Parliament House. Eliza, plenty of debate about whether it's a worthwhile investment.
Yeah, Sophie, lots of debate around this policy, which will bring multi-billion dollar manufacturing projects in areas like clean energy under a new umbrella called the Future Made in Australia Act. This policy would see an even bigger expansion of government intervention in the private sector by offering incentives to certain projects. The PM says the rest of the world is already going down this path and we need to play catch up. But the Productivity Commission boss, Danielle Wood, has raised some concerns with the policy. She argues it could create a new class of businesses forever reliant on subsidies and divert resources and workers away from other parts of the economy that could otherwise be more productive. It was a view rejected by the Labor Party's national president this morning as government ministers came out to defend the approach.
Well, she's completely out of touch with the international reality. I mean, all of our major competitors are doing this. We have to be in it to win it.
She's been very critical of what the government's proposing here at the moment. The fact is that over the last 2 years, manufacturing businesses have gone into bankruptcy. It's gone up by 300%.
If there's some people who want to put Australian manufacturing in the museum, well, I think that's just a complete mistake and sells our future and the apprenticeships and the jobs of the future short.
Sophie, the Act will cover existing schemes like the National Reconstruction Fund, the domestic manufacture of batteries and solar panels. New projects are expected to be unveiled in the lead up to the budget next month.
Eliza, thank you. To news just in, a car has ploughed into a childcare centre at Guildford in Sydney's west. Children were evacuated to the back of the building on Palmer Street and were not in the front room at the time. The driver, a woman in her 30s, is being assessed by paramedics. A Subway store on the Gold Coast is the latest target of Queensland's youth crime crisis. As Yasmin Bennell explains, the alleged thieves caused thousands of dollars in damage but didn't manage to make off with any cash.
A group of teenagers have broken their way into this Subway store at Yatala using a grinder to get through the front gate and then smashing their way through this window. The thieves then taking off in a getaway car believed to be stolen, heading southbound down the M1. It happened around 2 o'clock this morning. Thankfully, the store was closed at the time and no one was inside.
I've got staff now today who are not going to have a shift because Lord knows how long it's going to take us to actually get this back to a state where we can open and trade. You guys who do this, honestly, brain dead. Get a job, have a life.
The thieves making off with nothing but an empty till. The police are this morning searching for that getaway car and the people involved.
A car has smashed into the side of a house in Sydney's southwest, narrowly missing a child on a bike. Erin Ramsey reports.
This Hinchinbrook home is a mess after a Toyota Kluger crashed into the side of it last night, the driver and her four passengers emerging uninjured. The SUV turning onto Liverpool Road around 8 p.m. when it lost control, hitting a retaining wall before flying into the yard of a home, the car narrowly missing a child riding their bike in the street. The car took out a tree, a street sign, the fence and part of a brick wall before landing on its side.
I thought it was an earthquake, like a big bang. It's like boom.
She turned the wheel too fast, which she lost control of the car.
Behind the wheel was Brandon's 45-year-old mum, Yvonne, who had only recently got her red P plates.
And how is she feeling today?
She's all right, yeah. Accident happens, you know. Yeah. It's all right. Everyone is all right. My brother, my sister.
Brandon and his family were travelling to their home in Fairfield from a friend's place nearby when his mum lost control. They all managed to free themselves from the car with just a few scratches and bruises.
I started smoking, which I turned the ignition, but yeah, luckily nothing happened.
The occupants of the home were there at the time, but no one was injured. As for the boy on his bike, a neighbour has told Nine News that he looked okay, but was shaken up. The driver underwent mandatory testing, but police say this incident is a case of misadventure. The major clean-up now handed over to the insurance companies.